Ken Hilpner. I'm kind of going to be the MC today, and I'll speak in a few minutes more visually, kind of introducing what we're doing. But I first wanted to let Steve Pacala, who is the director of PEI, PEI, Princeton Environmental Institute, where we are. Steve's going to start us off, and then we're going to hear from Tom Barron, and then you'll get me again. So
I just have a few short remarks. I want to thank you all for coming here to the Environmental Humanities in a Changing World conference. This is sort of a culmination of a dream of mine. When I came here just over 20 years ago, PEI had just formed. We were a union primarily of scientists, engineers, and social scientists. We were looking for dance partners in the humanities, but somehow it never seemed to happen. Now, with this conference, I think the union is clearly pregnant, and so it will be time to get married. The reason this is so important is that I like to think of the undergraduates that we teach today as a crisis generation, a generation that's going to see humanity reach its peak population size, probably, while it's still poor, with maximum habitat destruction and quite possibly the next great mass extinction unless we get our act together. It'll also see, if we're lucky, peak CO2 in the atmosphere. And if we don't get our act together, it'll be a generation that can see clearly into the onrushing abyss. To succeed, it's not going to be enough for scientists to figure out what the consequences are and to close the remaining uncertainties about predictions about these problems. It won't be enough for engineers to invent magic bullets, and it won't be enough for economists to in their cold actuarial minds, weigh costs and benefits ever more accurately. What we're obviously going to need is for humanity to somehow find the nobility and the virtue and the maturity to do what's right, and that is the domain of the environmental humanities. In 1941, the scientists of this country were called upon to put down their toys and roll up their sleeves in the service of humankind. And I think of this as sort of 1941 for the environmental humanities. I want to thank you all for answering the call early. The conference today is really the vision and the work of Ken Hilpner. Riding my bike over this morning in the ice and trying to parallel process, I was trying to come up with a decent Milton analogy, you know? But humanity on the burning lake, you know, and it just wasn't working for me, Ken. I'm sorry. And so it was a burning planet, I think. And so Ken is visiting the Tom Barron Visiting Professor in Environment and Humanities at Princeton. He's a Milton scholar. He's been a fantastic visitor while he's been here. His day job, his usual job, is at the University of California at Santa Barbara, where he directs the Environmental Center, Literature in the Environment Center. He is a Harvard PhD, and as I think I said, a Milton scholar and an expert on the environmental humanities. This conference is really the result of his tremendous energy. I've enjoyed the conversations I've had with him, which have been primarily about science, technology, policy, and woodworking, right? I think, yeah, okay. So he's going to come and talk and introduce the conference in a minute, but first you're going to hear, one other thing I wanted to tell you. The other day there was an undergraduate in my office, a woman named Elizabeth Gatto, who isn't here, so I'm not too worried about talking about her. She's a freshman, and she was asking me for advice the end of last semester about what courses to teach. Now, she's the kind of Princeton undergraduate who is going to be president of the United States or empress of the world or something like that, right? She's people who are more organized than she is are generally locked up somewhere, you know? And so she had done an exhaustive statistical analysis gleaned from online sources as to who were the best teachers at Princeton. This is from a freshman, right? Her theory of becoming educated is to follow the best teachers, not to follow subject matter. And so she, from all the professors at Princeton, she had four names, and one of them was Ken Hilpner's. This after teaching a single course and being here for only 3 months. So well done, Ken. All right. I want to now turn to Tom Barron, who is a long-term friend of humanity and of PEI. Although I get pessimistic when I think of the way in which we're making progress on environmental issues, my one real source of optimism is the enormously gifted undergraduates I see all the time who have moved into this area and intend to devote their lives to doing something about it. And that sort of the intensity of purpose and the extraordinary gifts of intellect together make me think that somebody may just pull this off in the end. And I think that these are the kind of people that Tom Barron must have been as an undergraduate. Tom was a Rhodes Scholar, winner of the Pine Prize. He went on to a successful career in business and then became an award-winning writer. And now he is an impossibly generous philanthropist. And as I said, he's a long-term friend of PEI. I thank you for supporting. Six of the people here have spent extended periods at Princeton because of Tom and his family's generosity. So thank you, Tom, and I'm going to turn the floor over to you.
Thank you, Steve. You know, I will say that actually, to correct the record, on two fronts. One is that those young people that Steve referred to, I certainly wouldn't have ever been part of. I couldn't have even been admitted to Princeton today. But I will say, and having a son who's more accomplished than I ever was at the stage, I can honestly say that. I will say, though, that they are my greatest inspiration, just like Steve has said, and I'm sure many of you feel the same way. Those young people with their high ideals, their courage, their boldness, their devotion to their friends and to the planet, they really do renew my hope. And I'm and all of us feel that despair now and then. And it's really an amazing source of renewal to be among these young people who both care, understand, and are ready to go to work to save the planet that we all share.
Excuse me, sir. You have to just plug it in. Sorry.
Okay. Well, here I'll come over. Let me also say that whenever I have an opportunity to give a talk, especially in a room like this, where my first association was taking the course that was nicknamed Rocks for Jocks in the introduction to the geology in this very room, I remember the advice that my mother gave me the very first time I ever did a public talk of any kind. I was, 9 years old or something, and she looked me right in the eye and said something immensely helpful. She said, "Tom, don't try to be intelligent or articulate or charming. Just be yourself." A bit of a double-edged sword there, but I came to appreciate it with time. Anyway, listen, first, before I give you just a few thoughts briefly, I really want to say a heartfelt thanks. And it, first of all, goes to all the people at PEI, most prominently Steve Pakala, someone for whom the phrase fearless leader, I think, was designed. And it's really true, Steve. You've done a marvelous job leading this charge, and we're all here because of that. And I think we are all equally grateful to the people like Kathy Hackett and Holly Wells, Dan Rubenstein, Rob Sokolow, Ken Hiltner, all of whom have made such a difference. And to the many people we're going to hear from today. So looking forward to hearing all of you. And I have to say, most of all, I am thankful for my wife, Curry, whose wisdom and passion for the earth have inspired everything that my family has done for PEI and for to help this beleaguered and bountiful planet of ours. By the way, it is the Curry and Tom Barron professors, and for very good reason. So let me start out by reflecting back personally. I remember as a child the very first time I saw the the stars on high as a kid growing up in Colorado on a high mountain ridge. It was a summer night, almost at the time of the Perseid meteor showers. There were no lights, no artificial lights to distract from that vista. There were so many stars, all so bright. I felt like I almost had to squint to look up at that sky. And that vision filled me with a sense of wonder and awe and mystery. What William Wordsworth called in that wonderful poem, Lines Written Above Tintern Abbey, a presence that disturbs me with joy. That summer night, I realized for the very first time that being in nature, in wilderness, I could feel both very small and very large at the same time. When we are under the stars or by an ocean shore or in a redwood forest or a wondrous place, we can feel small and humbled, which by the way is very good for us human beings, while at the same time enlarged and enriched by our connection to all of that. That grand sweep, that majesty that's sometimes called creation, we can be enlarged by our connection to it. And nature is really the source of that inspiration where we can feel so small we are at the subatomic level and so large we are as big as the cosmos. How remarkable is that? So that experience left me with that deep wellspring of wonder and a lifelong desire to learn more about this remarkable cosmos we're part of. Another youthful memory I'll share with you was of my mother at age 60, when she decided she would go back to school to become a geologist. Now that was a very long way, let me tell you, very long way from 40 years before where she was a student of French language and literature at Smith College. So both temporally and intellectually, she was taking a big leap. And what I want to share with you only is the way she explained her decision to me. We lived in a ranch house in Colorado. It was a mile-long dirt road driveway up to the house. And I remember walking up that day from where the bus had left me off on the highway, and I dropped my backpack as usual, opened the refrigerator to pull out a glass of orange juice. And I looked over and I saw her. She was sitting looking wistfully out the window at Pike's Peak, which there was a wonderful vista out the window of Pike and the Rampart Range. But something was different. And I looked at her and said, "Is anything wrong, Mom? What's up?" And she looked at me and she pointed to the mountain and she said, "Do you know what that is?" Now, my mother, iconoclast that she was, I knew the wrong answer would be to say, "That's a mountain, Mom." So I said, "No, tell me what it is." She pointed at Pike's Peak and she said, "That is a book. A book with many stories to tell. And I am going to learn how to read it." Now, you'll notice two things about these little anecdotes I've just shared with you. They both invoke loving as well as learning. We are still, at our core, emotional beings. We have these extraordinary capacities for rational thought and inquiry, and they can be empowered or derailed by our emotional selves. Just as we rely on stories to understand our lives and our world, we yearn for knowledge to understand the greater story of which we are all a part. Do we hope to change human behavior, to affect economic markets, technologies, and public policies? More than that, do we hope to survive as a species? If so, we will need all of the above. We'll need all the comprehension we can gain from the sciences and all the context we can gain from the humanities. Comprehension and context, the twin pillars of our hope to survive and flourish on this wonderful planet we call Mother Earth. We cannot prevail, alas, with only the facts. We need to inspire loving as well as learning. And to do that, we must rely, as Steve Pakala and all the people at this conference understand, on the humanities, our stories, our music, our art, our religion, our myths, our psychology, our history, and our cultures. The voices of all people from all times. Consider the power of such stories to enlighten and inspire. Now, most people, I suspect, would not think of the Bible as an environmental treatise. Yet, what else is God's command in Genesis that we are given the Garden of Eden to till and keep it? Isn't that telling us that the future of our tilling depends on the wisdom of our keeping? Or think about Noah's Ark. To be sure, that is a story about faith and the power of faith. But it's also an environmental parable. Think about it. It is a parable about stewardship. Essentially, the Endangered Species Act of 5000 BC. Seriously, if God told Noah that he had to go through so much trouble to protect all the creatures of the earth, how can we do anything less? Just as modern science, the realm of discovery, can help to inform the humanities, literature and the arts, the realm of metaphor, can help to express modern science. My whole worldview changed when I first encountered the writings of Lauren Isley, a paleontologist by training, but a poet by nature. In one essay that some of you may know, he mused about geologic time while walking in the rutted hills of eastern Montana. Have you read this? He was searching for fossils of saber-toothed tigers, and he described the folds of that landscape in eastern Montana as the surface of a huge exposed brain, and the fossils he was seeking as the remnants of forgotten thoughts. Now, how could anyone hear that metaphor from a scientist who understood the lilt and power of language and not gain a fresh appreciation for evolutionary biology and geology, as well as the human condition? That's the power of story and language, the power, indeed, of the humanities. The context we gain from humanities isn't just limited to our own lives either, our own present story. It helps us connect to a future untold story. We will need all of our better angels, as we all know, if we're going to protect our planet for all the children and species and ecosystems to come. Either that, or we will drive ourselves and other creatures to extinction. There's a lovely Greek proverb some of you may know. No man stands so tall as when he kneels to plant a tree under which he will never sit. So these thoughts are quite ancient. And by the way, there are many modern examples of such wise writing that bridges modern thinking, ethics, language, and science. For example, Mary Evelyn Tucker's Journey of the Universe, which I recently read and was really taken by. I highly recommend it. And now let me conclude by citing one more venerable source. You've heard me quote from some lighthearted texts, like the Bible. So now I'd like to quote from that poet of profound seriousness, Ogden Nash. Quite fitting for this hall that holds so much geologic history, he wrote a poem called The Fossils. And here's how it goes. At midnight in the museum hall, the fossils gathered for a ball. There were no drums or saxophones, but just the clatter of their bones, a rolling, rattling, carefree circus of mammoth polkas and mazurkas. Pterodactyls and brontosauruses sang ghostly prehistoric choruses. Amid the mastodonic wassail, I caught the eye of one small fossil. Cheer up, old man, he said, and winked. It's kind of fun to be extinct. I'm sorry, I couldn't resist doing that. After enduring many lectures in this hall, I had to bring a dose of irreverence to it. But fun? Well, I'm not so sure. What do you say? Let's not go extinct. Let us save this wondrous planet for all times. And let us raise our voices in story and song, inspired by all that we learn, as well as all that we love. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much both to Tom and to Steve for the introduction. So I wanted to thank everyone for coming today in spite of the fact that it's snowing pretty badly out there, which I have to say to me, coming from Santa Barbara, is kind of welcome. I'm from New Jersey, so actually seeing the seasons is fun. And I also want to thank all the people that are watching us today, not here directly, but this is going out live over the internet. And this will also be put into rotation on a local cable channel. And more than that, this will go up on YouTube as a series of lectures, and this will be sort of a continual resource, and something new for PEI, it will go up on iTunes University as a collection. So I'll talk a little bit about that. And it's been my experience that people are actually watching these. So I gave a talk here a couple weeks ago, and I talked, for example, about the nostalgia that we have for the past, how it's translated into things like our nostalgia for heirloom vegetables, and maybe not in such a good way, in that, you know, genetic diversity potentially could be limited because of that. And people all of a sudden started writing me because they've been watching this and sort of, you know, defending my attack on heirloom vegetables. So, and I mention that because someone actually wrote me yesterday saying they'll never think of heirloom tomatoes the same way again. And she said she is coming to the conference, so this is sort of the backstory. If I get pelted by tomatoes at some point, you know why. I wanted to thank, first off, all the people who made this possible. And to make possible what I just talked about, Lance Harrington's in the back, who's actually been coordinating all this as far as the internet connection, and also set up our iTunes University presence. So many thanks to Lance and all the people at the Princeton Broadcast Center, and the people here too today. So the leadership of PEI, so Steve Bacala, so the associate director, Kathy Hackett, is sitting here, and Lars Hedden, who couldn't be here because we're gonna hear from him tomorrow, it's pre-recorded. He's in Africa at the time. He's the director of the program in environmental studies. But especially the staff, because really I've been a sort of bystander to this whole thing happening. The staff are the people who's made it work. So Holly Wells we have here, Laura Matecha, I don't see, who's probably out coordinating something outside right now. Igor Hayfitz is taking photographs, is our webmaster. Raj Shoshki, who is back here. This is why this works, because of Raj. Angela Petras, Stacy Christian, and many others. It's really their efforts that made this conference more than anything else. And of course, I want to thank all the participants who've come here in snowy days. So the idea for this conference, at least to me, came in part from a wonderful conference the PEI staged back in October called How Climate Works. The actual title, the full title is How Climate Works, a symposium on the fundamentals of climate science for scholars, students, and the general public. I thought that was just a wonderful idea to provide this sort of overview of how climate works for a range of individuals, not just scholars and students, but the general public as well. And, you know, it was great because for me, outside of the field, it explained things like, you know, climate in the oceans and that sort of thing. So the idea for this conference, in a way, is to do the same for the environmental humanities, especially since a lot of people don't know what the environmental humanities are to begin with. So we're going to hopefully answer that today. And more importantly, I think a question that I'm asked probably more than any other, especially by students, and that is, environmentally, what can I do to help? Students ask me that all the time. And when students ask it, it's not just that they want a specific question like, you know, grow heirloom vegetables or something. They wouldn't come to me for that. But they really are asking it in a much deeper way, sort of a vocational way. So it can in part be the sort of classes that they should take, but also the sort of majors they can think about, things that they can pursue. And in its most direct vocational way, they're really asking about the sort of, you know, careers that they could embark on. And when you think about it, that's a really touching question, because what they're really asking is, you know, if I were to devote my life to environmental causes, what sort of thing could I do? I just find that, and I get that question often, sometimes phrased close to that way. It's just very, very heartening, I think. And the answer to that, there are many answers to it. So on the one hand, and I think one of the more obvious answers, because the environmental sciences have been so active for so many decades now, is that you could, you know, follow in Steve Pakala's footsteps. You could become a scientist interested in something like earth science and sort of directly tackle issues of climate change. But the answer is less clear when you start thinking about the humanities. So what if your interests do lie elsewhere? Not in the sciences, but how about in art, or poetry, or theater, or anything of that sort? How do you help environmentally? What are your options? What are the things that you could do? So this conference is going to, by way of example, offer different answers to that. So art, for example. If you're interested in art, how do you make an intervention? When I get done here, our first speaker is going to be Ed Bertinsky. Ed Bertinsky, you may already know kind of the answer to this question if you've seen the award-winning documentary on Ed Bertinsky, Manufactured Landscapes. Ed Bertinsky's traveled the world with a very big camera, taking very big pictures of changing landscapes, of sites of environmental devastation, manufactured landscapes. Through his art directly, documentary, another documentary coming up, literally millions of people have been alerted to the problems, have seen in a very visceral way, have been asked to interpret directly, you know, this situation, this environmental situation that's unfolding. To me, that's an enormous case for what you can do environmentally to help from the point of view of art. What if your interest is in poetry? Again, not necessarily intuitive what you would do. Well, first, tomorrow morning, our first speaker is going to be Princeton's own Paul Muldoon, who, of course, you know, is an award-winning poet. He's won the Pulitzer Prize, the T.S. Eliot Prize, and others. And for decades, he's been enormously influential and in the public eye with poetry, in part, that has an incredible environmental message. So part of that answer is going to come tomorrow from Paul Muldoon with respect to poetry. So what if your interest is in theater? Tomorrow we also have Steve Kossum and Michael Friedman. I should mention in passing, these are both Barron visitors, and we'll talk a little more about that coming up. But together they staged this incredible theatrical performance. Some of you may have seen here a few years ago, The Great Immensity, which they've traveled the world doing. And again, this is theater as a way of communicating environmental issues to a broad audience. Alternately, what if you have an interest in music and nature, specifically in the sounds of nature? So tomorrow we're going to hear from Bernie Krause. Bernie Krause has, for the last 45 years, really his entire life, he's been traveling the world documenting changing landscapes, but unlike Ed Bertinsky, not with a camera, but with a microphone. He's literally gone back again and again to places like the Amazonian rainforest, recorded the soundscape there that has been changing over the decades. Enormously important work. And I should mention on the Register of Music that we have a very special treat, that tomorrow, the finale for this conference is going to be Paul Muldoon and his band, the Wayside Shrines, are going to do a set here. So this is unusual for an academic conference, but it should be great fun. And talking about what can be done with the point of view of artists, I was at a dinner last night for Tom Barron, where I met a young reader. I think her name was Jacqueline. She was 8 or 9 years old, and she was a fan of T.A. Barron's works. And I, having read some of it myself, I asked her what she thought of The Lost Years of Merlin. She started talking about it. And I brought her attention to a scene where this young boy climbs up to the top of a tree in the middle of a storm and starts shaking back and forth. And I asked her if she remembered it. She immediately did. She started giving me some of the details. And I asked her what she thought of the actual moment where he was at the top of the tree. And I want to quote this exactly. She said, "That was so scary and so amazing." And what's striking about that is that what Tom Barron did there was not tell one of his own stories, but that's actually a story from John Muir, who he brought into this book for young audiences, for young adults, to introduce them to what I teach as one of the iconic experiences of the sublime appreciation of nature that John Muir had. And what that sublime idea, this gets theorized, the 18th century by like the philosopher Immanuel Kant, by Edmund Burke and others, is this idea of at once being so fascinated and pulled in toward nature, and yet on the other hand being frightened by the sheer enormity of it. And it was just extraordinary that this 8 or 9 year old perfectly expressed the definition of the sublime experience of nature that was so scary and so amazing. So it's another answer to the question of what you can do from the point of view of art environmentally to make a difference. In this case, by introducing a range of important environmental themes to a group of young people who may never go on to read Muir. If they do, they're going to find something kind of surprising and familiar when they get there. Anyhow, if you're not an artist, what can you do if you have an interest in humanities as well? Say, in philosophy, religion, politics, history, other cultures, the study of literature. So what can you do to help environmentally? This conference is also going to address that question from the point of view of scholarly work. We've brought here today and tomorrow enormously respected leaders in a range of fields in the environmental humanities to talk about what they do, either to talk about it more generally or to display for us, to give us an example of how they do their scholarly work. So, for example, with philosophy, we have Dale Jamieson, who is the director of the Environmental Studies Program at NYU, will introduce us to eco-philosophy. For religion, we have the dynamic duo of Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Grimm, who are going to talk about eco-religion. They're coming to us, by the way, of course, from Yale, the Yale School of Forestry. And again, I'll mention and explain later, they're also former Barron visitors. So politics, for example, we have Dave Schlossberg, who's come probably further than anyone else for this conference, from literally the other side of the planet, from the University of Sydney, also a Barron visitor, to talk about politics and ethics and similar issues. If your interest is in history and literature, two of my favorites, we have a number of different people who are going to talk about these issues from a different perspective. So Karen Thornburgh, who's come to us from Harvard University, is going to give us a very interesting perspective on the literatures and cultures of East Asia, something we don't always think about here in the U.S. Kimberly Ruffin, who has come to us from Roosevelt University, is going to be talking about African-American eco-literary traditions. And Joni Adamson from Arizona State. And incidentally, last year, Joni Adamson was the president of the National Association for the Study of Literature and the Environment. And she's going to be talking about issues of environmental ethics from the perspective of literary studies. So just enormous group of scholars, I mean, this enormously fascinating group of scholars speaking to the issue of environmental justice. And environmental and humanities. And we're also going to hear the perspective of the environmental humanities from the environmental sciences, and this is going to come from PEI's own Rob Sokolow. And the interesting story I have with Rob is Over 40 years ago, in 1971, Rob coordinated the public lecture here called On Wilderness. That was the title, Rob? And what's interesting about that is, I mean, what we're trying to do together, do here, you know, in general, is bring together the environmental humanities, the sciences, and focus on it. 40 years ago, Rob did that with this public lecture series, bringing not only scientists into the discussion, but people from the environmental humanities, both artists and people who are doing research. So, for example, Edward Albee, who is, of course, you know, playwright. And then at the same time, Leo Marx was here as well. And Leo Marx is, for those of you who don't know, sort of an esoteric field, enormously influential early environmental critic. So in some sense, you know, PEI has had an interest in environmental humanities here for literally decades. So in addition, this conference is not just for the public and for students to introduce them to these things, but to also encourage sort of cross-pollination of ideas, which really is what the Barron program has done from the beginning. So I should also note that I will not be doing individual introductions for everyone, just to know, because I started looking at what that would entail, and I realized we're going to spend 5 to 10 minutes on everyone here since we have such a, you know, an acclaimed bunch. So you should have a copy of this. If you don't, you can get it at the door. We have little bios here for everyone, so once I introduce folks, you can look at that if you would. So I did want to say a word or two about the environmental humanities here at PEI, and it does go back far, at least 4 decades with Rob, at least 2 decades more formally. I know in 1991 was the inception of the Program of Environmental Studies, and then PEI actually was formed officially in 1994. So that means next year we have there's going to be a big anniversary here, I would presume, for PEI's 20th anniversary. But 2003 also marked the inception of something important, and that would make this the 10th anniversary of it. And that's the beginning of a real push toward the environmental humanities here, which was especially made popular through Curry and Tom Barron, through the beginning of the Curry C. and Thomas A. Barron Visiting Professor in the Environment and Humanities. So when I've mentioned these folks here who are Barron visitors, they're all part of this program, as am I. These are all individuals who came from all over the place with interests in the environmental humanities. But what's really interesting about that is, although they're coming from the perspective of the environmental humanities, the things that they've worked on here are really fascinating. I'll give you just a quick little list. They've explored conservation, energy efficiency, clean air and water, species diversity, sustainable development, wilderness preservation, environmental justice, and climate change, all from the perspective of the humanities. That's an extraordinary thing to happen, and it really says something about the openness of PEI to these different perspectives. I mentioned that Paul Muldoon and this banner are going to be our finale, but in a way, their opening act is going to be a roundtable in which half a dozen of the Barron visitors, myself included, will be kind of talking about our experience here in the environmental humanities more generally. And I should note that as much as there's been a great interest here in PEI in the environmental humanities from the environmental sciences, which is just amazing, it's also the case that the interest goes across the university, across campus, from a variety of different places. And I just want to give you a little list of the people that have groups that have co-sponsored this event, because it really says something about how enthusiastic the environmental humanities are getting, sort of enthusiastic reception we're getting here. Co-sponsored by the Council of the Humanities, the Lewis Center for the Arts, the Department of English, Bill Gleason is chair sitting here, the Program for American Studies, the Center for African American Studies, the Department of Religion, East Asian Studies Department and Program, the Department of Philosophy, the University Center for Human Values, and you get the idea. Just enormous interest here. And in a way, then, I think it's fair to say that PEI is sort of setting the standard for environmental studies programs in the environmental humanities in the US and really the world. I also wanted to talk a little bit about the public outreach that's been going on here, and to this we really have to thank Holly Wells, who is PEI's Manager of Communication and Outreach. An enormous amount has been done here to bring the environmental humanities to a diverse audience. So I know both John Grimm and Mary Evelyn Tucker have done public talks while they were here to like DNR Greenway, to the Princeton Food Salon. I'm also doing that. Holly sets all this up. She set up a public talk, a panel that she had me involved in a panel at the local public library, the talk that I gave a few days ago. And in general, there's this desire to reach out to a larger audience and expose them to the environmental humanities, which is part of the conference today. And it's noteworthy that this extends not just to the general public and to Princeton students, as you might imagine, but in 2 weeks we have an event coming up which is also for Princeton alumni. And what's going to happen is I'll be giving a talk here. There'll be students here, some members of the public, but also this will be a webinar and it'll go out live over the internet, and we're opening up a channel so that alums will be able to ask questions and I will be able to answer them directly. So it's all part of this getting the message out for the environmental humanities. And I should also note that this carries through with undergrads and students in a very direct way. There are over 30 courses on the books here at PEI that have some sort of environmental humanities context. And that's amazing. I just can't imagine that anywhere else, so many courses. And these are courses like culture and the environment in Asia, writing about nature, religion, ecology, and cosmology, the journalism of energy, the American environmental history, the ecological worlds of Japanese culture, environmental history, Darwin in our time, and so forth. And I should mention that there's one course, if I can get it up here, show you. This is the course that I taught last term, thanks to Lance Harrington in the back of the room working the camera, who spent last night working on this. This is the first PEI course that is going up on iTunes University. All the lectures for this course are viewable from iTunes University by anywhere, anytime in the world. And I think this is such a great initiative on PEI's part to get that message out to a whole range of people. So you can click on these and you'll unfortunately have to listen to me talk. So, and you know, I should mention, even though he's not here, Lars Hedden, who is the person who's been pioneering all the, pushing this forward in the last few years. And that's amazing too, because his focus here has been on the environmental humanities, but Lars, of course, is a professor of ecology and evolutionary biology. So it's just great that he's looking forward to those programs, and a proponent of things like the humanities cognate among the certificate in here, as well as senior thesis research, interns, and that sort of thing. Also, I should note that the graduate students here, as much as we've received a great reception among scientists, those of us in the environmental humanities, among scientists and among other, you know, parts of the university, graduate students have been very enthusiastic about it. So tomorrow afternoon, we're going to be hearing from a group, goes by the name of PECS, which is an acronym for Princeton Energy and Climate Scholars, who are principally students who are into science, into policy, and into engineering, but they have this great desire to incorporate the humanities more into their group. So they're actually going to be making a pitch tomorrow to get more environmental humanities people involved, which should be great fun. It's also the case that there are just, you know, incredible number of resources here for faculty as well, including conferences like this. The last thing I wanted to show you, and this is just actually kind of a sneak preview of something. First is this. If you were to, as I did here, Google the phrase environmental humanities and scroll down so you can see this, what would happen? What happens now is, notice these, not the first one, but notice the second Princeton EDU, third Princeton EDU, fourth Princeton EDU. Three out of the five hits on Google for environmental humanities, at least in this local form. If you did this in, you know, France or something, I think Google is localized. But now list Princeton environmental, will now take you to the PEI website. And that just seems to me astonishing. And in part, Igor Hafitz, who was around here a minute ago taking pictures, is our webmaster responsible for that, getting the word out on the environmental humanities here. This has happened just in the last few months. And in part, it's because of things like when I gave my talk, Igor promoted that on Facebook. Within an hour, we had over 100 likes on Facebook for that talk. And what that's done is just generated so much interest in the environmental humanities, and it's centered here at PEI, which I think, you know, nationally is where it should be. But the bigger surprise I have, and this is just a little teaser here, is this. At PEI, when I first got here, I mentioned to Kathy Hackett and to Holly Wells, just in passing, that it seemed to me there was so much material on the environmental humanities in the PEI site, it would have been nice if we were all in one place. And Kathy said, okay, and then started to do it. And this initiative is what's come out of it. I mean, it's literally been an incredible initiative on part of the staff. They've been working this week, especially feverishly, getting this together for us to see, where so much of this activity that's been going on for, you know, 10, 20, 40 years has been brought together here, and this is now what is being officially referred to as the EHP, the Environmental Humanities Initiative at Princeton. It's part of PEI, consequently exists in the PEI site, but you can go here and look at the participants, faculty, students, the kind of research that's done, education, you can see all those courses that are listed. If you go to outreach, you can see the kind of events that Holly's been organizing. And it just seems to me just a wonderful thing to have available to people all over who are interested in the environmental humanities, who can just come here. First off, what do they know about environmental humanities? Maybe nothing. All you need to know are those two words. You Google them, hopefully you'll get led here and to PEI, or then to this little logo will appear on the PEI webpage, and then led into this portal and see all the amazing work that's being done here. And I have to say, in closing, to me it's just been really encouraging. I almost feel like a kid in a candy store coming here, because the enthusiasm and support for the environmental humanities that's here has just been astonishing. It really has. So without further ado, you can stop listening to me. And the first person we're going to hear from is Ed Bertinsky. And Ed Bertinsky, of course, is the wonderful subject of manufactured landscapes. And Ed will be talking about his new work today. So, Ed Bertinsky.